Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Revenue Revolutionaries. I'm your host, Dave Duke. This week, I sit down with Mike Weir, the CRO at G2, one of the hottest SaaS companies in the country. Mike has a wealth of experiences, and he talks about his transition from marketing leadership to sales leadership, a revolutionary shift for him that has really paid off. He'll talk about why it's so important to have a passion and understand the purpose of the work that the organization is doing. He'll talk about why it's critical that you understand the goals of your team members and help them craft their career trajectory. And he'll also talk about how he thinks about staying close to the market as a CRO, one of the key responsibilities to ensure that he knows how best to create a vision for the organization. I'm so excited to welcome Mike Weir, the CRO of G2, to Revenue Revolutionaries. Let's go. Hey, Mike, welcome to the podcast. Great to be with you today.
It's great to be here, Dave. Looking forward to an awesome conversation.
I really appreciate it. And I'm so excited to talk about your career journey and the lessons learned along the way. So let's get into it. You've held multiple sales and marketing roles throughout your career. I know you spent some time at CDW and LinkedIn. How did those early experiences shape your path and what you're doing today at G2?
Yeah, so I would love to say that I had an amazing career path mapped out. It's really come together over the last few years, but in the early days, I loved marketing. You know, the ability to help represent a brand, to be able to show the company that I was at, you know, what the value was that we could be creating for, you know, a business, a government, any kind of higher educational entity out there. And so as I went on that marketing journey, I realized more and more how much I loved engaging directly with clients. The fun, the optimist in me of, let me get out there and help you see the potential of this in a very direct and kind of one-to-one way. And so as I evolved in my marketing leadership roles, I really quickly got the itch to get more client side, to own the quota, to own the revenue, to be a part of bringing customers into what technology we were building. And so they kind of complemented each other very well, leading up to, you know, my current capacity as the Chief Revenue Officer at G2, where I need to be thinking holistically about what do our clients need. Mm-hmm. So having some of that marketing background and having the direct selling background certainly helped me think about customers first.
Yeah, that's excellent. I understand, you correct me if I'm wrong, but at LinkedIn, there's just an awesome environment for leadership development. Were you able to tap into that? If so, how so?
Yeah, absolutely. LinkedIn puts an exceptional amount of time and resources into developing the talent of the organization. Mm-hmm. Talent's always been the number one priority at LinkedIn. It's something that sticks with me to this day, always putting my team first. Mm-hmm. To make sure that they're on a really good trajectory within their career at a team and a very personal level. So some of the things from my LinkedIn days that stuck with me was making sure that we're creating space for people to engage outside of their day job.
Interesting.
Okay. Being able to learn and experience things from the culture of the organization, from external thought leaders, so that I, you know, when I was at LinkedIn, big part of my happiness in job wasn't just the job. Uh-huh. It was all of the culture around me, the learning experiences around me. And then when we did have very formalized training, they sought to bring in great thought leaders, really proven experts that would just help us think differently. Mm-hmm. And not really allow us to follow status quo, like kind of challenge yourself, think differently, take intelligent risks. And so having an organization that rallied around pushing you out of your comfort zone in a really good way was fantastic for me in my own professional development. And it's something that I've carried with me to help my own teams.
That's awesome. There's a few things to unpack there as we get into the conversation more. But talk a little bit about your responsibility at G2 as a CRO. How do you think about the role?
Yeah, I don't think about being a CRO just as managing the sales stream.
Okay.
I think that's one way when you think about, you know, sales leaders, I would say it's not effective if you're just caring about what's in pipeline. Do we have enough pipeline? Is it progressing? Are we closing enough? You know, as a CRO, I look at it very holistically from a client perspective first.
Okay.
From a market perspective first. And for me to add incremental value to the business, I need to be thinking about what's going on in the marketplace. Mm-hmm. I need to be understanding what's going on with our clients. What are they looking for? What options do they have out there? What techniques, as the marketing clients we engage with, like what techniques are they using? Mm-hmm. What's proven to be really valuable? And how do we ultimately provide value in their strategy and delivering on the objectives that they have? Mm-hmm. And then mm-hmm. with that kind of external perspective, it gives me the potential to create more of a vision for my team of where we need to go to, how we need to be highly consultative in engaging with, learning from, and providing ideas to our client base. And then just assume that everybody's going to really do a great job managing their pipeline and progressing deals, but help them to see what's going on outside of our walls, help them see where we want to get in the next couple of years.
Excellent. How do you think about staying close? What do you do to stay close to the market and to the customer base?
Yeah, well, having conversations like this certainly helps me to stay fresh and understand, you know, what everybody's thinking about, what challenges other people are grappling with in similar types of roles, similar types of companies. Mm-hmm. I'm an avid reader, participant in webinars, online events, live events, whenever that's back in vogue again. Yeah. Just being out there and being a part of the marketplace conversation, it's extremely important to just see the conversations, spark my own ideas, talk to other experts out there to, you know, see if they're thinking about similar things. Practically, I cultivate and work with a lot of folks that have similar roles to me, mm-hmm. or folks that I've used to work with that are just amazing, smart people and have regular one-on-ones to talk trends, to talk business, to just bounce ideas off of each other so that we're kind of each pushing each other to think differently.
That's great. And so important to just keep things sharp, if you will. And I love the variety there. I think that's fantastic. When you talk about casting a vision within the organization, are there any strategies that you've kind of honed over the course of your career to kind of put that stake in the ground and get your teams marching in the right direction?
Yeah. So as I joined G2, one of the first things I did was, you know, not take my own biases into account. I had plenty of my own ideas. I had plenty of thoughts about the amazing stuff G2 was doing that I would love to do more of. Mm-hmm. But I sat down and, you know, kind of no matter where I'm at in my career, where, what company, I want to learn what got us here. Mm-hmm. And so I sat down and learned from the organization, why has G2 been so successful? What's working exceptionally well? What ideas are out there already mm-hmm. that, you know, I could help bring to the forefront? Mm. After going through that listening and that learning and a lot of discovery, a lot of questions, mm-hmm. after I had that really solid knowledge of the foundation of G2, the value we provide, after talking to more and more customers and hearing directly from them, then it was on me to start creating the 3-year vision. Mm-hmm. And I like to blend very long-term vision mm-hmm. with short-term operational needs to get us on the path to realizing that vision from 3 years. Because I've been in organizations where we paint this grand picture of where we're going to be in 3, 5, 10 years.
Yeah.
But then you don't really know what we're doing right now to pay off that vision. Mm-hmm. And so some really great mentors early in my career helped me to create that better blend. Mm-hmm. And so that's always been a part of my process of learn the organization, learn the value we're creating, understand the direction we need to go in, paint the picture of here's where we want to be in 3 years and why.
Yeah.
Here's the kind of value we want to be creating in the marketplace. And then build short-term strategic planning rhythms mm-hmm. that allow us to keep revisiting, are we on the right path still? Are we doing what we need to keep paying off that 3-year vision? And then every year we refresh it.
Got it.
We still like where we want to be a couple of years from now, or are we going to kind of change the trajectory of the company with a new idea?
Awesome. So, yeah, it's kind of like
you got to know the plan. Well, there's the plan, but then there's also just the kind of the emphasis on execution. Like, we can't go realize this vision unless we work together in these increments, right?
Absolutely.
That's excellent. Kind of another angle with that, you know, how do you think about casting a vision with a customer in the sales process, but then ongoing throughout the life cycle, really in kind of the vein of adding value over time or delivering value?
Yeah. We, at the core, we need to know what our purpose is.
Mm-hmm.
And if we are very true to what value, what need are we filling in the marketplace? Mm-hmm. Like at G2, we want to educate every single prospective client and existing client about how buyers are using our platform to make really informed decisions on the software they want to buy for their company. Right. And then we want to help advise them, again, whether they're a prospective client, brand new client, or they've been working with us for years,
mm-hmm.
how is that buyer behavior evolving?
Mm-hmm.
What are the things that they're doing differently? What is the information that they're looking for? And mm-hmm. how can I bring you into that process
mm-hmm.
in as organic of a way as possible so that you're a part of their experience and you're creating value for yeah. them? And in turn, you're building trust, credibility. And then as a marketer, you're going to get that lead eventually. And the salesperson is going to have a more qualified conversation with somebody that you've been building trust and rapport with for a while. So we just want to make sure that we know the value we provide to the market and bring our clients into that value exchange in far more organic ways than yeah. just forcing it in. Like, I don't want to just throw gates around all the content and right. generate a bunch of leads. And then your sales team finds out they got a bunch of false contact information and nobody's returning their emails or right. nobody's picking right. up the phone call.
Yeah. And it's such a unique opportunity to help other organizations position and set expectations with their prospective buyers or their customers even. So it's an interesting intersection that you guys sit at. What, talk a little bit about just how you think about building teams in your role today and as you've done throughout your career. How do you think about that construction?
Yeah. So when I think about kind of talent first philosophy, I want to make sure that we know what is everybody's goal
mm-hmm.
in their career. What is your aspiration? What makes you really excited about your job?
Mm-hmm.
And ultimately, where do you want to go in the future? And then as a leadership organization, we then want to talk about and share what journey are the people on our team on?
Mm.
Because I can look at this in a very progressive way and say, I want to get the most out of everybody on my team while they're with us. Because in the modern workforce, I know people are not joining one company and retiring at that same company.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to make sure to help everybody continue to evolve and grow their skill set to find that ideal next job.
Mm-hmm.
We hope to keep you here as long as possible and make you as productive and successful as possible.
Right.
But I know that you're eventually going to move on. So I just want to understand, you know, what role we're playing in your journey, how to help you thrive in the job you're in today, how to give you advice on growing into that job of the future. And then when I know what that job of the future is, I want to use techniques like succession planning, formalized organizational planning that helps mm-hmm. me see where is this amazing talent wanting to go next so that we really start knowing how people can progress well within our organization.
Really good. And just to kind of play that back. So it really is setting expectations out of the gate of your intention to help them develop and kind of recognizing, as you said, that this is a stop along the way and we want it to be a long stop, but, you know, a long duration, but you know, we're here supporting you, whatever that path looks like. How has that served you over time as you've built the teams?
I think it's served exceptionally well. I have dozens and dozens of lasting relationships with folks that have been part of my team, with people that have been, folks I've reported into
mm-hmm.
because, you know, we've known that we're here to help each other out. And yeah. to your point, I want to make sure that's as productive and as lengthy of a journey as possible. And so having those fair expectations with each other, having a transparent conversation, make sure that we stay on the same page. Mm-hmm. And so we've successfully built teams out and given more visibility to the broader organization about where we're going, mm-hmm. so that they can do internal career planning. They can continuously revisit what are my goals and what could be really interesting that's coming in the future for the organization, so that they can stay and they can thrive. And whether they stay in the same role they have right now, we're also looking at what stretch projects, what experiences can I put in your path that helps add to your time here, that helps add to your background, your credibility for the next job that you do want. So we are stretching people in role outside of just what the day-to-day qualifications are, to help prepare them for the future, to help assess a career pivot that they may be considering. Like, I've had folks in my sales organizations that wanted to go to business development, and I've had them help co-lead projects with our business development team to get to know that team, to see what their day job was like, to see if that was really interesting to them. Mm-hmm. And in some cases it validated, like, that's awesome, I want that type of job.
Yeah.
Help them get ready to make the pivot. And in other cases, they realize that's not what I'm looking for. I'm going to go a different direction and assess differently where I want to be in 2 years.
Yeah. So you're going to proactively and kind of encouraging that, but then there's also a little bit of like, going to dip your toe in it and let's not fully make that jump, because it might not be a good fit, but let's kind of work through that together.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
that's fantastic. What, back to kind of the role that you sit in today, what does the CRO role look like in the next 5 to 10 years? Do you see it evolving in new ways? It's starting to really grow in its popularity.
Yeah, I do see it evolving in some pretty interesting ways. One, the more revolutionary potential change that we've been seeing out there with organizations like Cisco and Intel and even some more consumer-oriented brands, they're moving to a chief growth officer who has the chief revenue officer and the chief marketing officer reporting into that individual to create a far more unified and aligned go-to-market strategy. Mm-hmm. So I think there's a lot of companies that are thinking about how do I as a CRO drive more and more alignment with my key internal executive peers? Like, I want to be very aligned with my CMO. I want to be very aligned with my chief product officer.
Yeah.
So that we are thinking about the customer experience. We are thinking about the value we're creating in the marketplace. And together we're building a shared roadmap of, here's what my team is going to do to realize that future. Here's what product is going to build. Here's what marketing is going to change in our messaging, our focus areas, our targeting, to help pay off that vision in the marketplace. And so CRO is going to be a very, very collaborative, cross-functional role in the future.
That's great to hear. And it's exciting for customers too, because we need more of that kind of holistic view of the life cycle and the revenue cycle, just to deliver a great experience. Because that we all know how it can break down without that purview. That's excellent. You dropped the word revolutionary, which is awesome because of the last name. Talk a little bit about things you've tried in your career that you would put in the category of being revolutionary. And what were some of the lessons learned along the way?
Yeah, one that we're already on is just I would call it revolutionary to move from a marketing leadership role to a sales leadership role. Mm-hmm. We work very collaboratively, but oh my gosh, until you do both jobs, you don't realize what you don't know. And so that was one of the bigger revolutionary steps just personally in my professional career to say, all right, I'm going to move from running marketing organizations to jump over the fence to the team I've been talking to day in and day out, and live in their shoes, own the quota, own the pressure and responsibility of that, and think about how do we, have great client conversations that deliver the value? How do we build long-term relationships and stay with those companies, those customers, so that they love us for years to come? And it's just, it is a big leap, but it's a lot of fun. It's really great to see how the other side lives and to bring forward, like, as a CRO, helping my team understand how marketing thinks. So we build better internal partnerships.
Yeah.
But then also our clients happen to be marketers too. So how do we think more like our clients to be even more valuable and consultative to them?
It's great perspective and such a great lesson in getting perspective, you know, especially with you know, all the teams that exist, this need for alignment. And it's so much easier when you kind of understand what it's like to be in those other roles. That's great. A couple more questions for you before we wrap up here. And I'm always eager to understand how leaders use data or don't use data to make decisions. And it's kind of that, you know, go with your gut type of angle. Have there been instances in your past or one specifically where you went with a gut decision and it proved to be the right decision and you kind of decided to go that way instead of using the data?
Yeah. So I've become a very data-driven thinker. Uh-huh. Sometimes it's because of just the scale of the organization and operation. You got to make sure you're not following outliers and you're not following a squeaky wheel.
Yeah.
But there's been plenty of times where it's just felt right and we've pulled the trigger. A lot of times it will actually be in a product.
Okay.
Where, you know, we want to move quickly. We want to be innovative. Mm-hmm. And it just sounds right. You're talking, you know, to a customer or you have an idea and you know, I've gone to our chief product officer at G2 a few times already and been like, hey, I think if we do this, we're going to help clients a ton. Mm-hmm. And one client actually brought it up with me. We should go out and build X.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Some of the ones I'm thinking about right now are live examples that are not fully in beta. So I can't fully say those, but
no problem.
In the past, you know, when I was at LinkedIn, one of the big pivots, kind of quasi revolutionary ideas was, you know, we in the marketing solutions business, we were working with marketers, helping them use our media solutions. And we just said, you know what? We need to be helping sales teams too. Because mm-hmm. our marketing team needs to be working with their sales team to really get the value of the media that they're using from us. And so we didn't do comprehensive data analysis or anything. We're just like, this just makes sense.
Yeah, yeah.
Marketing wants a better relationship with sales. We can help. And so we started building up narratives, marketing, started teaching our team how to bridge the divide and created like a whole practice around marketing and sales alignment, which seems, you know, now seems normal. But when we started doing this in 2014, going into 2015, marketing and sales alignment was not something that a lot of people were talking about in the industry, mm-hmm. and certainly not a media company
really
talking about here's how to do it, because it actually puts more pressure on your media. But sure. We knew it was the right thing to do. And so we worked with a lot of our clients to help them make the transition to better working with their sales team to deliver a real business impact, not just some of the vanity metrics that they like talking about.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks for sharing that. And to your point, sometimes it's just the logical kind of progression of how things are kind of unfolding or evolving. So love that example. Final question for you, and I ask everybody this question. If you could sit down with anybody for a cup of coffee, who would it be and why?
Yeah. So I need a clarification on this one. Is this alive? Is this anybody in history?
All fair game. Yeah. It could be alive, dead, famous, not famous. It's up to you.
Yeah. This is, I've gone through this one as a dinner party type topic. It is a tough one. One, you know, a person from history that I would love to sit down with if I knew how to speak Italian better would be Leonardo da Vinci.
Oh, okay.
Just soak in the brilliance that was this guy. I mean, I'm amazed at all he did within his life and all the kind of areas and the pivots of, you know, being like a great engineering mind, a great artist.
Mm.
I was literally just a highly gifted person a very long time ago, and to this day is still probably one of the most brilliant people that people talk about. And so I would love to just hear how that guy thought.
Excellent. Excellent choice. I like that one a lot. I'd take that coffee as well. Well, Mike, thank you so much for spending time with me today and sharing your background and kind of words of wisdom along the way. Really, really appreciate it.
Thank you for the opportunity.
What a fantastic discussion with Mike. So grateful for him giving me some time and, you know, just a great perspective on what it takes to build a business within the CRO role, you know, that recognition that taking experiences from other disciplines and from marketing to sales is really, really powerful. And, you know, thinking about how do you position an individual on your team for their future? I thought that was some really great insight on setting expectations with team members and really having their best interests at heart. Well, thank you for joining me today. I really, really appreciate it. I hope to see you again for another episode of Revenue Revolutionaries. This has been a MetaCX production.